Adolph Rupp was born on the Kansas Plains near Halstead, September 2nd, 1901. He played on a national championship team at Kansas University. He learned his basketball from the famous coach, Hog Allen, and from the game's inventor, Dr. James Naismith. Rupp had refined his art in high schools at Burr Oak, Kansas, Marshalltown, Iowa, and Freeport, Illinois. John Maurer had quit as Kentucky's coach after the 1929-30 season, and UK's Illinois-dominated athletic department had heard about the young coach at Freeport.
40 seasons ago, Adolph Rupp arrived at the University of Kentucky. In that time, he has fashioned the greatest coaching record in the history of basketball. Coach Rupp, let's reminisce a little bit about some of the great players and the great games and the great teams we've had at Kentucky.
Well, Cade, would that take a long, long time? Unfortunately, we don't have any records of any of these teams, these early teams, at least as far as they're recorded on tape. The first ones that we have are those of the Fiddling Five. And, of course, we've had some great moments prior to that time. When I think about the time that my boys stood on the podium at Wembley Stadium in London, England, and were champions of the world, when I think about the Fabulous Five, when I think about the two championships they won, and then again repeated in 1951, of course we have no records of that as far as tapes are concerned.
Coach, let's reminisce a little bit. Do you remember your first game at the University of Kentucky?
Oh, I certainly do. It's just as plain as it can be, and I was scared to death. I came down here. I didn't know a thing about any of these teams that we were playing. And, of course, the schedule was handed to me, the same as they are today. Many of our games are scheduled 4, 5, and 6 years in advance. And so I had nothing to do with these early schedules. And I didn't know anything about the strength of these teams, but I was scared to death. And, of course, even today, I'll be just as nervous when we go out against West Virginia as I was in that first game when we played Georgetown College in 1930.
Coach, you've become famous for one thing, and that's a superstition, I suppose it is, the brown suit, the man in the brown suit. Why?
Well, Kaywood, when I was coaching in high school, in those days, of course, if you had two suits, you were very fortunate. The salaries were not too good, and the clothes were not too plentiful. And so I wanted to look real nice in my second year of coaching, so I went out and bought a blue suit. And we went to that game, and we were shellacked. So I said, uh-oh, this blue isn't the kind of suit to wear at a basketball game. So I went back to brown, and I've been wearing brown ever since, and goodness knows I've got a lot of brown suits in my closet.
Coach, we mentioned the Fabulous Five, a team that won two NCAA titles for you in 48 and 49. You came back to capture the conference championship the very next year, 1950. How come you didn't get a shot at the NCAA?
Well, we weren't invited. In those days, the teams were invited to the NCAA tournament by a committee. And although we had a fabulous record, we weren't invited. And we tried our best to get an invitation to this thing and should have been invited. When you won two consecutive NCAA titles and then aren't invited back to defend that championship, there's something wrong with the committee. But we weren't invited back. Then the following year, with a green team, almost sophomores, we were invited, and of course we won it again in 51. I have no hesitancy in saying at all that we would have won in 50 because we had a veteran ball club that year also.
Your fourth and last NCAA championship, Coach Rupp, must have been very gratifying with a team called, for some reason, the Fiddling Five.
Well, it certainly was because we weren't expected to go anywhere with that team. I didn't expect to. I think the boys were the only ones that thought they'd go anywhere, and I don't think they were too sure about this thing. We didn't have a lot of support anywhere. And this bunch of kids, they just kept winning. They just fiddled around and fiddled around, and finally, with about 2 or 3 minutes to play, they'd get busy and they'd win a ball game. Just about killed me. I'll tell you, that was a bone-crushing season for me. And finally, we got into the playoffs. We beat Miami in the first game by 20. Then I think we beat the winner of the Notre Dame-Indiana game, which was Notre Dame by a very substantial score, I think something in the 30s. And that qualified us to go to Louisville, where we had a very, very fine crowd backing us. We beat Temple in the first game, of course, as history has recorded. We beat this great Seattle team with Elgin Baylor at the throttle, and we won that game by a nice margin of victory. And that, of course, shows that a bunch of boys, even if they aren't,
the national championship lays on that line. Kentucky leads 80-70. Bernard Hatton moves in against Francis Saunders. Here's the tap to Don Mills. Under the basket, Cox lays it in. Johnny Cox gets his 10th field goal. He leads Elgin Baylor in that department. Here it is under the basket to Frizzell. Another check us, yes. Frizzell laying in his first field goal of the second half. Kentucky is on top now, 82-72. Here it is to Don Mills, flips it over. Vernon Hatton jumps, lays it in. And for Vernon Hatton, that's his 8th field goal. There are only 5 seconds to go. Kentucky has a 12-point lead. Elgin Baylor takes the last shot of the ball game. No good. And the hey, boy, the national champion, Kentucky Wildcats.
Coach Rupp, we've listened to some exciting moments of Kentucky basketball past, but I think I would be remiss if we didn't bring up a team in 1966 that was called Rupp's Runts that really captured the fancy of the crowd.
Well, I think that was, I would have to say, the greatest team that has ever assembled on a basketball floor. I heard many people say this summer, I had many coaching schools all over the United States, I've had coach after coach tell me that is the best ball handling team that they have ever seen. I believe that. I'm sincere. I was prepared to make the statement that if we had won that last game, that was the greatest basketball team that had ever been turned out in collegiate ranks. And of course, you know the history of that team. And it is a small team, but certainly was a courageous team, a wonderful ball club, and it'll be a long, long time, I believe, until we're able to put together again a bunch of ball handlers the way we had in 66.
And the pass is into Dampier. He comes out of there, slips, and gets away from Martin. 14 seconds. He's in front court with the ball. He hooks one to Cron. Over to Riley. 10 seconds. Out to Conley. Back to Riley. Riley comes out, gives to Conley. There's a foul on the play. Waller fouled Berger with 6 seconds. Adolph Rupp talking now with Larry Conley on the sidelines, and Berger's first shot, good! Berger has given Kentucky a 3-point lead. Now, hit or miss, you'll see Kentucky give Georgia a field goal. 6 seconds, the shot on the way, good! Berger hits again. Georgia's got the ball. 5-4, Martin, Harsher, shot, no good, and the ball game is over. Kentucky beats Georgia in 2 overtime periods, 69-65.
Unwavering in his zest for combat, Rupp was sidelined during the 1970 season with a foot infection. He watched Dan Issel, Mike Pratt, and company crush the opposition with his foot propped on a pillow.
Well, I'm making progress. I'm coming along just nicely. I stopped acting the part of a doctor now, and I went back to coaching. And as a result of that, the doctor's getting along a lot better, and I am too.
That team, that Issel and Pratt crowd, won 15 straight. In 1972, Adolph Rupp was forced to resign his spot on the Wildcat bench at the age of 70, the mandatory retiring age for university employees. Rupp left the game after 42 years, 876 wins, 27 SEC titles, and 4 NCAA championships.
At the time, he was the winningest coach in college basketball history.
To those of you that went down a glory road with me, my eternal thanks. Good night.